So in every workplace, every school, every game, sports event, if you look in your life now, there's always that place in life where you're trying to move to the next level. You're always trying to be the best that you can be. You're trying to stay late from work so you impress your boss. Or you might stay up like 24 hours straight to get to the next video game level. And we'll do whatever it takes to get to that point. And so God was just really pricking me today for this week was, what are we willing to do to take our next step in the Lord to the next level? Are we comfortable with where we're at in the Lord? Are we fine with where God has us? Are we being challenged in the Word? Do you know your calling and your destiny in your life? Some of us here might be, you know what, Stephen? I'm in a bad spot. I don't know where I'm at right now. Some of you might be confused. And some of it might be at the top of the game. I think in general, it's super important to really raise our game and do whatever it takes to do what God has called us to do. Does that make sense? So I want to look into the Word this morning or this evening. If you have your phone Bibles, regular Bibles, I don't care. I want to talk about the what. What does it mean to take it to the next level? So I want to go to Deuteronomy 1:11. It says, "May the Lord, the God of your fathers, increase you 1,000-fold more than you are, and bless you just as he has promised." So what's the key word there, guys? Increase.
What did you say? Deuteronomy 1?
Deuteronomy 1, verses 11. And this is NASB, for those of you that care. "May the Lord, the God of your fathers, increase you 1,000-fold more than you are and bless you just as he has promised you." So, the first step is, it means to have increase. The importance of taking to the next level is for God to increase you in what he's doing. Can you guys agree, if you're never in the Word, you're never praying, you're never seeking the Lord, do you think God's going to give you increase?
No.
So that's the totally opposite, right? You got to be in the Word, you got to do your diligence, you got to stay focused, you got to have purpose in what you're doing. And if we're thinking that, God, why aren't you not using me? You know, and there's nothing on the foundation of that. What are we doing? So number one is increase. In Colossians chapter 2, verses 19, and I'm going to be jumping from scripture to scripture tonight. Paul indicated that as believers hold fast to Christ, the head, that they grow with the increase that is from God. Another increase. Hold fast to Christ, the head, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. Next verse, next book, Isaiah 43, verses 18 through 19 says, "Do not call to mind the former things or ponder things of the past. Behold, I will do something new. Now it will spring forth. Will you not be aware of it? I will even make a roadway in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." So number one is increasing. It means to have increase. Number two is experiencing something new in the kingdom. Have you ever got like a new gift? Or like a new basketball? Or a new video game? Or a new promotion? Or a new wife? No. What does new mean? It's fresh. Right? It's something that you are looking forward to. It's something that is fresh. It's new. So God is wanting, it means to bring freshness, to bring something new in what God has called us to do. I know there's a period in my life where I was just like kind of like flatlined for a long time. I didn't know who God was. I didn't care who he was. I was a pastor's kid my whole life, missionary field. And so I just kind of like flatlined. And so I kind of assumed, because of my background, that I was supposed to be some nice, saved kid, you know? And so I think in my heart of hearts, I was really desperate for looking for something new in my life, to really, really feel the presence of the Lord. So number two is something new. The next one, it says, now it will spring forth, will you not be aware of it? So you get the increase, you get something new, so now God wants you to spring forth. I wish I had an example of like a spring, what a spring does. What does it do?
Swings.
It springs up, right? There's action to it. There's direction to it. So it means to spring forth, guys. Do we want to be men that are holding back and staying back? Or do we want to be men that want to be sprung, that want to be forward in what God has called us to do? Yes, no?
I'm the second one. I want to be the second.
You're the second. What's the second one?
Spring forth.
Spring forth.
That's right.
Yeah. And I, any place I'm at, my job, you know, I just started a job last year. And, you know, I really asked the Lord, you know, I'm here for a paycheck, obviously, but what can I do to really, really, you know, just do what you have me to do out there? And so I felt, as the time went by and I kept seeking the Lord, asking the Lord who to talk to, you know, not everybody, but there's a couple guys there that kind of just have opened up a little bit. And so springing forth and going, you know, God, Lord, I want to increase, and I want you to do something new, so now spring me forth. So I think those are the three things. What does it mean to have a new level in the Lord?
Fresh bread.
Fresh bread.
Less stale.
You know when something smells stale, right, Rick?
Mm-hmm.
You immediately know it. I love personally smelling new reading books. Don't judge me.
When you don't read.
I flip the pages and I love the newness of the pages. It's crazy. I love it. I don't know why. It's just it's the aroma, it's the newness of the book. Even though I don't read a lot of books, I don't know why. I just love it. Anyway, that's just exciting.
New is exciting.
New is exciting, right? So you have those three. Now you go to the why. Why is it important to get to the next level? John 15:2 says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. Have you guys ever pruned a tree or something? Unfortunately. Pastor Adams, you got a lot of time in that. I remember one time when I pruned Free the Fellowship's trees when I was doing landscaping for that church. I'd been there. And I butchered the tree. Like, I stripped it. Like, I totally chopped like the whole tree down, basically. But I left like the parts where, you know, the creek myrtle, it kind of goes forth. And Pastor Bill's like, what did you do? What happened? Did you like get blind or something? I'm like, no, I pruned them. Because when you prune something, it produces more fruit when you prune it. Is that right?
Yeah.
Am I talking crazy here?
Yeah, don't kill it.
Yeah. I mean, you can go down to the root, you kill it. But with this particular, you know, I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with crepe myrtles, but they you cut them, you prune them, and then you spring back. So, is there areas in your relationship with your Lord where it's not bearing fruit? Question to ask yourself. Are you bearing any fruit? Let's just start there. And what is the outcome of your relationship with the Lord? It's like God giving, like, it's like somebody giving you the basketball, saying, here you go. And you're kind of like, you know, well, what do I do with this? What do I do with what God has put in my hand? And God wants you to use it. He wants you to dunk it. He wants you to shoot it. He wants you to pass it. He wants you to dribble. He wants you to spring forth in what God has given you. Number two, Hebrews 12:11 says, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it afterwards, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. So you have bearing fruit. So then, why? It creates a life of discipline. But why do you guys like discipline? And I'm not talking about like punishment wise, but really disciplining your life. So what God has called you to do? A disciple? That's not easy. It's not easy being a disciple. Right, Pastor Adam? It takes a lot of hard work. It takes a lot of commitment. It takes a lot of dedication. And a mindset that's, you know where you're going. And you'll do whatever it takes to get to that step. So it really creates a life of discipline. Back when I was growing up in sports, I played basketball and baseball, champion poet, but the softball.
Is that why you wore that shirt?
Well, I'm a champion in Christ.
Rip it, bro. Come on.
Thank you, bro. Thank you, Gary. Thank you, man. Yeah. Let's go, man. But it's fine. Well, champions are good either way. Anyways, my point was, I spent a lot of time playing basketball. It was my main sport. And I breathed it. I played it in snow. I played it in rain. I could care less where it was. If I had a basketball and a goal, I was playing like midnight sometimes. My mom and dad thought I was nuts. But as a result of that, it got me to a championship.
Softball.
Not softball. It was pretty rewarding. Like all the hard work and discipline I put into that season or two, it just showed me how much fruit that bore, having that much discipline to get ready and prepare for what the season was ahead. So number one, we're bearing fruit. Number two, why our relationship should go to the next level is to create a life of discipline. And then number three, how? So how do we apply this to our daily lives? How do we bear fruit? How do we allow the increase of the Lord to come upon us? Any thoughts?
Be obedient.
Be obedient.
Humble ourselves, maybe.
Okay. What's some practical things?
Spend more time with Him.
Spend more time with Him. What else, guys?
Gotta hear Him.
Gotta hear Him.
Gotta learn His voice.
Gotta learn His voice. That is correct. Anybody else?
Read the Word.
Reading the Word. How about accountability? Yeah. Right? I have a couple guys in my life.
Champion.
I did not plan that.
Yeah.
Why didn't you call me 30 seconds earlier?
Accountability, yeah.
To know Him and to make Him known.
Know Him and to make Him known. Yeah. That's really good, Ed. Discipleship, mentorship, accountability.
Well, it's everything you talked about already.
So that's true.
Look at what you talked about. If we want to go to the next level, we want to be used by God. We got to discipline ourselves. We got to get rid of junk out of our lives and make room for Him. We got to hear Him. You got to be obedient to somebody else said. And you got to show Christ like Ed just said.
That's right.
So, I mean, it's all of it.
Yeah. So, what's one of the two main focuses for Freedom Fellowship? Does anybody remember?
Discipleship. Connect.
Discipleship was one of them.
Outreach.
Yep. Connect was one. Outreach. What's another two important ones in there? I think it was the last one. Spending time in
Word. Worship.
Worship. And
prayer.
So I could go rabbit trails and give you all these little tiny little details of how to become great in the Lord. But we're really focusing on really, really entering a really a different area of prayer and worship in our life. So you say to yourself, Stephen, I don't even know how to pray. Okay, so what? So what is prayer about?
Communication.
It's about communication from the?
It's a conversation.
From the heart. It's a conversation. Right. So how do we build a daily walk and apply that to our life?
Practice.
Practice. So with practice, you have to
do
it. Right? So what is keeping you back from doing it? I'm challenging myself too. If I haven't prayed in like 3 weeks, I feel like I really missed the ball. That's for my family, my job.
It's distractions of life.
The enemy will come in and destroy me at any possible angle. I'm serious, guys. It's real life. I'm not sure if you guys have experienced it, but I have. If I'm not walking in prayer, if I'm not walking in worship, thankfully I'm on a worship team. And I get to live in it like every week. But prayer, well, I had a long season where I was not praying. I was making some stupid decisions. So I finally one year said, you know what, I'm just going to pray. I'm just going to start. Start praying to my wife, praying to my kids. And you know what? I'm at peace. I really feel like God, this is where God has me in His church. God's put some things specifically in my hands to be leader of this church. And I think it's just been a result of a relationship with the Lord. Period.
It's true.
It's not about what I've done, it's about the good things I've done, Lord Champion, you know. There's none of that. It's all based on the fruit that's coming out of my life. And I'm not trying to boast here, guys. I'm just saying there's an effect. There's a reaction to what we're doing here. And so the challenge for you tonight is, are you doing what you need to do to take your game up a level? It's important, guys. Whether you're in marriage, whether you're young and you're in school, whether you're really, really experienced in life and have been through a lot of different storms and tribulations, prayer and worship. That makes sense?
Yes.
Any comments on that? Any thoughts?
It comes back to one word for me. And one word for me is relationship. If you don't build a relationship with Jesus, you can't get anywhere. If you guys that are married, if you don't build a relationship with the girl you married, you're never going to get married. You got to build a relationship with people to have some of these things and to walk with God and to get to the next level. You got to have a relationship with Jesus. You got to know His voice. You got to have that relationship to hear where He wants to take you and what He wants out of you to get you to where He wants to take you to. Because obviously, like I'll speak for myself, there's a lot of stuff in my life that I had to get rid of to make room for Him. Because I was involved in a lot of different things. Had no room for God in my life. Had to make room for God in my life and build that relationship.
And if you don't make room, He takes it away.
Okay.
You know, Stephen, if you're going to another level, a relationship is alive, and a relationship should grow.
Yes.
And if you're growing in your relationship, then we should be continually hitting new levels.
Right.
Our game should be continually going up.
That's right.
If our relationship is growing.
It's true.
So that level should be a continual thing. And if we're not getting to it, if we're not up in our game, there may be a question about the relationship. We need to do some work with our relationship.
Absolutely. You're totally right. And another parallel word there, Dr. Ray, is, are we willing to do that?
It's a choice.
It's a choice. Mm-hmm. I can talk to Matt. gotta want to do it. That's right. Any other thoughts? Yes, sir.
I know you said earlier you didn't want to get into too many details about how to, you know, accomplish some of these things, but I think you would have some unique things to share from a standpoint of being on the worship team, and I've known you for a long time. You have a heart of worship. You know, specifically the place of worship in your devotional time, your daily time with the Lord, not when you're prepping for Sunday morning, but on a personal level. You know, if you could talk a little bit about that, I think that might be.
The biggest thing for me in that aspect is being cleansed from everything that's going on in here. And the biggest thing for me, and this is just from training in my sports days, is just preparing. I do it every week. It's like a mundane thing. I could just sit there and just think that I'm doing this every week. I'm playing drums this Sunday. I'm playing guitar this Sunday. You know, okay. But why am I doing it? Why has God put me there to be on a worship team? Is to show off my skills? No. Just to lead people in the presence of the Lord. So if I'm not right, if I'm here just acting on my skills and talents and not how the Holy Spirit is moving, then I've missed. So I think a big part to your question, George, is for me, it's a cleansing. It's purifying my heart. It's purifying my spirit and getting ready for each week. Did that answer your question?
Well, no, I wanted to go the personal route, not you as a worship leader, but in your just for your personal devotions.
Okay, what
particular how do you spend time with God?
How do I spend
time? Do you worship during the week? Do you worship?
I got an answer.
Go ahead.
Jordan, I'll speak from my perspective. Kind of what Stephen said, just really resetting things. And I really like David a lot, you know, because David was just real, you know, and he had a heart for the Lord. And what I love about Psalms is you see all of David's emotions. David complained a lot. You know, there's a lot of Psalms where he's complaining again. God, why have you forsaken me? Where are you? What's going on? You know, my enemies are all about me. And then about half. Picturing David writing those psalms, I'm just thinking about him in the midst of all that he's going through. And he was a worshiper. And you really can just see David in the cave being hunted by Saul, but he sets his heart right by worshiping the Lord. And for me, that's what it's really about, is despite the circumstances of life, he's still a holy God. He's still on the throne. Mm-hmm. No matter what's going on in your life, if you can get that worship into you, I think that really helps to reset your perspective on what's going on. Because it's not my plans, it's his plans. It's not my will. And really declaring the truth of the Lord and praising him no matter what's going on and creating that habit, guys, of worshiping the Lord in good times and in bad. That's what really carries you through. So that when you have a crappy week, you can crank up that music in your car. And it can really help to reset. Cool thing about church now, but I hope that helps. God's really challenged me on is I have a 30-minute drive to work every morning, and it's putting on worship music, and I worship when I pray for 30 minutes on the way to work now, just
people might need that, that step, you know, just depending on where you're at. But just because of just, I mean, every week I kind of have like a set thing. I listen to worship songs beyond what the set that we're looking, that we're listening for Sunday morning. So there's that intimate time with him. There's in the word while I'm listening to worship songs.
Just tell them God what an awesome God you are. God, you're awesome. You're mighty. You're wonderful. You're loving. You're just worshiping God. And then going asking God, you know, just start a prayer. Going to prayer, you know, just talking to God. Just having a real conversation. You know, but you start off by extolling God, worshiping Him for who He is.
Yeah. And some of you might be here saying, well, I don't know how to do that. Look around you.
Well, like when you hear a song on the radio or something that's a worship song, and you sing
you know, and I work great at my job. You know, I'm not lazy because I want, if you say you're a Christian and you do a lousy job at your job, the first thing people want to say is they look at you as an imitation of Christ. Mm-hmm. And so by doing the job, whether it's you're a plumber, whether you're, you know, you're playing sports, whatever you're doing, I believe Christians should be the best that they can be at it.
Yeah.
I think that's also a form of worship.
It's true.
It is. You know, so I think there's a lot. So, yeah. I think that's a deep one.
That's true.
Yeah, it's true.
The Lord put you on this earth to do. You're doing it for Him too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So you really want to do it the best you can.
Well, the Bible says work as if you're working under the Lord anyway. So when you do that, you're honoring Christ. You're honoring God by doing it to Him.
So before we break up, guys, and play games or whatever, can we just all stand? Unison. I kind of want to just throw this song on one more time and just really just pray. If any of you have an unction to pray concerning our loved one, Lord, please feel free to pray.